Hi, I'm Matt Ozalis, an RF engineer at Keysight. This video is about how to design a stable high-frequency amplifier. It's the third video in the series. In the previous videos, I showed some of the basic concepts related to stability, including a measure called loop gain. So the objective for this time around will be to explore loop gain in a little more detail. I'll show four different techniques for deriving loop gain in a feedback system, and talk a little bit about the pros and cons of each technique. For all the videos in the series, you can follow along with the analysis by downloading the workspace. The link is below this video. I think it's a really good way to get a more complete understanding of the concepts that are presented here. For me, at least, I learn by doing things myself, and the workspace is great for exploring the concepts in more detail. All right, in the last video, I showed how amplifier and feedback blocks can be connected together to form a feedback system. And the key to whether that system is stable or not depends on the combination of the amplifier and feedback, which is called loop gain. If this loop gain circles clockwise around 1-0 on a polar plot, the system will essentially be unstable. And I showed an example last time of an amplifier and feedback block that were unstable. Now, first, I want to return to that example and describe what was inside of those amplifier and feedback blocks. Here's a more detailed schematic, and you can see it's just a simple transistor amplifier circuit, and this feedback resistor can be adjusted to stabilize or destabilize the circuit, which is kind of nice. In the last video, I designated the transistor as the amplifier block and the entire surrounding piece as the feedback block, and that was how I analyzed loop gain. Well, in this video, I'm going to actually go in and increase the feedback resistor value to make the circuit go right on the verge of stability, and I'm going to do that to illustrate a point, so bear with me here. You might also remember from the last video, to compute loop gain, I broke the connection between the feedback and amplifier, and then I inserted an AC source and injected a signal, and then I plotted the return voltage on the other side of the feedback loop. With the new resistor value, I can do the same thing, and now this circuit looks stable, so we're good. If you think about it a little more deeply, though, I'm not sure that this simple loop gain approach is entirely justified. First off, the voltage was injected through a 50-ohm source, and really I put this in there because I wanted to show the closed-loop transient oscillation. An ideal voltage source is a short circuit, of course, and if I put that in a closed loop, it would have dampened the oscillation in the transient analysis. On the other side of the feedback loop, the voltage came back into an open circuit. Why was it an open circuit? Well, no good reason, really, so perhaps it would be better to be more consistent with the termination on either side of the loop. And it's possible to do that using a component called Osctest in ADS, which is a classic oscillator design element. The nice thing about Osctest is that it consolidates loop gain into a single S parameter. Basically, there's one termination inside of the component, and the forward going wave directs out of this terminal, and then the return signal goes back into the same termination as a reverse wave. All that means is loop gain is collapsed to just one S parameter, S11 here. So I'll put the Osctest component in the circuit, and I run an S-parameter simulation. And then in the results, I can plot S11. And now the circuit is actually pretty close to 1-0, but it turns out it's just barely stable here. It doesn't quite encircle the 1-0 point. Well, I think it's reasonable to also feel a little uneasy about this approach. Osctest did keep the terminations consistent on either side of the loop, so that was good. But the default value of 1.1 ohm seems entirely arbitrary. I see a lot of designers make this mistake. You know, they take a component like Osctest and they stick with the default termination because it seems like there must be some kind of logic behind that. You know, 1.1 ohm seems very exact. Well, I've been designing high frequency circuits for years and I personally can't see any logic to the default value here. I mean, maybe once it made sense in some oscillator application, but it probably does not apply very well to this exact case. So the fact of the matter is this 1.1 ohm value is definitely not the termination that the loop sees when it's closed. If we change the location of the component, or also we could change the value of the termination, you can see that the results will actually be different. And while we're poking holes into this framework, let's add a few more holes. In the analysis so far, the signal can only flow in one direction, but that's not true in real life. Some of the input signal must flow forward through the feedback network to the output, and also a signal at the output can pretty easily flow backwards through the amplifier to get to the input. One more question, how accurate is the division of the amplifier and feedback blocks? Well, I'll push down into the transistor model. You can't always do this, of course, but here you can see the internal transconductance element, and it's quite clear that the gain piece is actually the transconductance. The rest should technically be part of the feedback network, right? There are potentially many small loops inside of the transistor itself, and these aren't part of the loop gain computation because they're completely self-contained inside of the two test points that we've been using. Okay, so let's tackle the impedance problem first. This is something that was described in the 1970s by Dr. Middlebrook, and he proposed a measurement technique whereby the loop's broken and two signals are injected, a voltage and a current, to null out the return voltage and current. And this was called double null injection. And from these values, it's possible, in fact, to compute the null voltage and current gains and then combine them into a single loop gain, which is independent of impedance. So it was shown to give the same result regardless of where the loop was physically broken, and it doesn't require some arbitrary terminating impedance. I want to make a brief side note here. Middlebrook actually used the Hewlett-Packard 302A wave analyzer to measure his loop gain in his paper. And that's pretty cool because if you look inside of those instruments, Bill Hewlett also employed feedback techniques and loop gain concepts extensively to design the test equipment. So loop gain concepts were used to both measure loop gain, of course, but also to design the measurement equipment as well. There's actually an IEEE paper I'm showing here that you can reference by Bill Hewlett. And it's a good read both because of the science and the history involved. And here at Keysight, we've got an exhibit that's got many of these historic instruments on display. So if you're ever in Santa Rosa, it's definitely worth checking out. Anyway, back to the show. In simulation, it's possible to emulate Middlebrook's original measurement technique by applying two test sources to the feedback loop, one voltage source and one current source. So that's what I've got here. I took the circuit, I put in a voltage source, and then I made a copy of the same circuit, and I put in a current source. And then I'll simulate to get the return voltage and return current. Now, in the data display, I can combine them into a single loop gain that is identical to Middlebrook's measurement. And from it, you can see the circuit appears now unstable, in contradiction with the earlier result we got from Osctest. All right, Middlebrook addressed the impedance, but the signal only still flowed in one direction. Dr. Hurst in the 1990s presented one way to address that. He proposed modeling the amplifier and feedback blocks as parallel bidirectional Y-parameter networks. And what he showed was that you can characterize these blocks independently and then combine them mathematically to derive a version of loop gain that accounts for signal flow in both directions. Y-parameters, of course, naturally connect well in parallel. And this has its own assumptions. Particularly, you'll notice that the block models are quite simplified compared to most cases in real life. I should point out that what Hurst was actually arguing in his paper was that loop gain methods were not entirely reliable because of these types of assumptions that get made, and that's what he was trying to show, but we'll talk about that more in the next video. But for now, I can emulate his method by just doing an S-parameter simulation of each of the two blocks individually, converting these to Y-parameters, and then combining them using the formula that Hurst gave. And when I do that, I get yet another polar plot showing the circuit is, again, unstable. So in conclusion, I showed you four loop gain techniques today. The not thinking too much AC source approach, the Osctest approach, the Middlebrook null double injection approach, and the Hurst bilateral Y-parameter block analysis technique. And you might be left feeling kind of confused here because two of these say the circuit is stable while the other two say the circuit is unstable. Well, remember in the first video I showed that K-factor has some problems with accuracy. Clearly, these loop gain techniques do too. At the end of the day, it's just not possible to draw a conclusion about stability from these approaches. They all make assumptions and simplifications. But don't worry, in the next video, we're going to return to fundamentals and I'll describe some techniques that we can have a little more confidence in. That'll be part four in the series, and please subscribe to our YouTube channel for updates. You can also download the workspace at the link below the video. Thanks for watching. Sorry to confuse you today. We'll straighten it out in the next video. Thank you.